Thank you. Thank you and good evening. Good evening. Just a second. I'm going to get set here. Oh, there. Everybody can hear me? We're good to go? All right, thank you guys so much for coming out tonight, and thank you for being here. I really appreciate this. This is such a treat for me to be here. I'm really thrilled that my parents are here with me tonight, who drove in to see this. And because about 48 years ago they hung out for one night, I'm here. So thank you. Thank you. So how many of you remember a show called Romper Room? Oh, yeah. Okay, so... I'm going to be reading a story from my book that I'm working on, Mr. Fancy Pants, and I hope that this will bring back some memories for some of you. This story is called The Son of Miss Sharon. My family had a secret never spoken of, never acknowledged, a secret which remained buried in our attic, accidentally uncovered the summer of my 15th year. And once the discovery had been made, our family was never the same. I am blessed with exceptional parents. I cannot imagine parents loving their child more, nor a child loving their parents more than I do mine. They have always encouraged taking chances, following your heart, not living life thinking could've, should've, would've. Better to try and fail than not try at all. If you've learned something, you haven't failed. The glass is always half full. You cannot control your circumstances, but you can control your attitude. Regrets are a waste of time. Look forward and never behind. Valuable lessons which I have applied to my life, and they have served me well. They also insisted on honesty, full disclosure. I thought I knew everything there was to know about my parents, but no, I did not. In the crowded, musty attic of our ranch-style home in which I was raised, set the ultimate grandmother's trunk. Metal and wood, gold-covered, covered with tiny rivets and inside a vast selection of treasures. Nana, my father's mother, kept a trunk of remembrances. Nana, who let me as a child decorate her house for Christmas to my heart's tacky content. Nana, who dipped rooster snuff and kept the souvenir glass that it came in. Remember that? Nana, who kept our family history alive within this trunk. Alive with souvenirs from foreign shores when my uncle served in World War II. Pictures of my father standing in front of the Statue of Liberty in his service uniform in 1958. Report cards, letters, a pair of dolls purchased in Turkey, a pocketbook purchased in Africa. A menu from my father's high school Halloween program in which sliced potatoes were called pirate's coins. I love this trunk, and it was within its deep recesses the family secret was revealed. I made this discovery, as most are made, quite by accident. One day in my rummaging for the umpteenth time, I came across a hitherto hidden cubby, the top of which was covered with a colorful graphic of a cherub. As I brushed my hand across its top, it moved. And lifting the top, there it was. Still in the original packaging, five finger puppets. And on the package itself, a red and yellow logo which read, Romper Room. Romper Room was a female-hosted educational television program for children which enjoyed the peak of popularity during the 1960s and 70s. During the half-hour broadcast, children would be taught the importance of good hygiene, being helpful, being kind, etiquette. Then exhausted, everyone would break for a snack. I had vague memories of watching Romper Room as a child. I recalled a mirror, romper stompers, the kids marching in a circle singing about how good they were going to be that day. As I gazed upon the finger puppets, I assumed it was a present my parents had forgotten to give either my brother or myself, and if so, I wanted what was due to me. I showed my find to my mother. Where did you find this? She asked, taking the package from me. In the attic, I explained. Do you know where it came from? My mother grew mysteriously quiet, paused, then smiled. Yes, I do. She then took out an old family photo album, one I had somehow missed as I loved flipping through these old albums to gaze at pictures of relatives I had never met and who were long dead. This album is filled with black and white pictures from my parents' childhood. My mother in high school looking every inch the stereotypical 1950s teenager. My father looking very dapper in his high school senior class picture. And a newspaper clipping and picture of my mother, circa 1966, sporting a Jackie Kennedy-style Dior suit. In one hand was a doobie, in the other, a magic mirror. "What's this?" I asked. "That's me when I was on Romper Room," she said casually. "Huh?" I thought. It took a few minutes for the significance of her statement to sink in. My mother, the woman who had made me mow the lawn, who made cupcakes resembling Easter egg baskets for my third grade class, the woman who dressed as a fortune teller for my elementary school fall carnival, and when I went to see her in her fortune teller's tent and recognized her, later denied it was her. The woman who was none too pleased when I came home with a D in math on my fourth grade report card. The woman who taught me how to count to 10 in Spanish. This woman, my mother, had been Miss Sharon on television's Romper Room. What? Now, even after I made this discovery, I failed to fully appreciate its importance. It wasn't until years later, when I would casually mention the fact to others, that I began to realize the impact Romper Room and Miss Sharon had on an entire generation of children. People were stunned with the news. And I began to appreciate how the children of a famous parent feels. I could now understand and relate to Suri Cruz, the children of David Beckham and Victoria Posh Spice Beckham, and Liza Minnelli. To many, my mother might as well have been Madonna or Cher. We all have moments in our childhood which make a strong, indelible impression, and Romper Room was one such moment for an entire generation. 25 years after Romper Room, Miss Sharon and I were out shopping. We were looking at some clothing and wanted to try something on, but the dressing room was at the opposite end of the building. When one of the clerks refused to let us use the dressing room without supervision, fearing we'd steal the merchandise, the other clerk, recognizing my mother, said, "No, it's okay. That's Miss Sharon." So fast forward several years later, I'm working with the comedy improv group Funbags. I act as an MC, direct, and am a team player. Now, during the crowd warm-up, I sometimes mention my mother was Romper Room's Miss Sharon, which never fails to elicit an audible gasp and some applause. After one performance, a man comes up and introduces himself and asks, "Was your mother really Miss Sharon on Romper Room?" "She certainly was." "That's amazing," he said in obvious awe. "I loved that show as a child. I'd watch it every day hoping she'd say my name in the magic mirror, but she never did." "Excuse me," I said. I stepped away and called my mother, and giving her the gentleman's name, tapping the gentleman on the shoulder, I gave him the phone. "Miss Sharon wants to talk to you." He was visibly shaking as he took the phone. "Hello," he said timidly. And without saying hello in return, I could hear my mother say, "Romper, stomper, bumper, boo. Tell me, tell me, tell me do. Magic mirror, tell me today. Have all my friends had fun at play?" And she said his name. Tears welled up in this gentleman's face. He was barely able to say thank you as he hung up the phone. And his hand still shaking, through his now steady flow of tears, he whispered, "Miss Sharon said my name." And with that, I left him alone, his shoulders shaking, choking with emotion. And later in the evening, still weeping, I overheard him on his telephone telling someone, "You will not believe what happened tonight."